So what Saikat just said is the answer. As the pressure on the news organizations, the you know, the channels or platforms increases, as it starts to hit the bottom line, they will understand that they need to now. It's a short-term game. We've played it long enough. And as the credible media gets back its act, you will start to see that the problem will start to wean off. It's a creation of, like I said, one side, the business of fake news, and on the other side, like we said, the politics of fake news. The moment advertisers, that's where the money is. That's the click business comes from all advertising. The moment that you actually squeeze the advertisers and they start to act responsibly, this problem is only going to get sorted then.
Okay. Miten, you're there from...
I just want to say that I would be very happy on the day that advertisers in India would, you know, grow a conscience when it comes to the kind of communal bakwas that is propagated night after night on some news channels.
It will have to. Or alternately...
I mean, take a stand, for God's sake.
Or alternately, you see...
Every day is a Hindu-Muslim issue.
Or alternately, you'll have to... It'll have to be regulated at some level, like we are saying. You know, now you're seeing Facebook, et cetera, bring in interventions because they're scared. And I think it's driven on one side from that aspect of regulation. On the other side, bang on. Big advertisers. We are not talking about small advertisers. We're talking about big advertisers, billions of dollars of advertising. Once that pressure gets felt, is the only way you'll get this sorted.
Okay, I'm just going to go to Miten. Miten, are you into the Times Group hearing? Is the Times Group hearing anything regarding pressure from advertisers, regarding news in general, on fake news in specific?
So I can't speak broadly for the group, but for the internet business, we haven't heard anything in specific quoting fake news as a concern.
Okay.
I think it's probably still at the rhetoric stage. People are trying to figure out where what. Also, one of the things is that, you know, we are a publishing house. We don't, you know, on the social side, we don't have any big platforms, unfortunately.
You do still have the third largest audience after Google and Facebook in that sense.
Yes,
right?
Yes, that we do.
That's the Columbia pitch.
Yeah. No, so that we do. But I think, I think the real concern around these things is that stuff is spreading fast. The whole challenge of fake news is if it has a certain velocity, right? And before somebody can come in and check it and sort of say, listen, this is real, this is not real. And that is, those are platforms that aren't sort of in our control that way. And I think that it does require a technology solution. I think it's not, technology can't be the only thing, but you have to find ways to, you know, even the readers have to take some something in their hand. We can probably talk about it later.
Just quickly add to that. Can I just add one point here? I mean, it's unfortunate. Sorry, we just have one advertiser here.
No, here's another advertiser here.
I mean, don't we think we need to reach out to more of the advertising community, the agencies, as well as the big corporate buyers, to actually come into forums like this and educate themselves about everything's happening in the world of fake news? Because they know about it, it's at a distance, but I don't know they know how much it's got weaponized, as you guys said.
But, I mean, look, the problem is that agencies have to justify it using metrics, and that's all they look at then. So they look at numbers in terms of TRPs, they look at numbers in terms of page views and uniques,
CPCs,
etc. And that's how it gets justified. That's how the entire fake news factories in that were operating out of Macedonia and all were working anyway.
I think right to free speech does not give you a right to anonymous speech. And I think one of the beauties of the internet, which I certainly enjoyed when I was a teenager and then growing up with it, was this amazing anonymous place. You could be anybody, pretend to be anybody, and go through, make connections, talk to people. But in 2018, I've changed my little view on this. I think that for certain platforms, for certain spaces, please feel free to say whatever you want and no one should stop you. But one, you have to own up to who you are. It has to be linked back to you to some extent. Second, you have to face the consequences.
If you look at this affidavit, if you look at the affidavit, there were fake profiles that were creation.
No, absolutely.
Creating, right? You're not going to have Aadhaar authentication for everyone
who uses Facebook.
Right?
But what I'm saying is that if you put enough pressure on the platforms, this is the only thing. I'll give you an example. Facebook 3 days ago said that we will solve the Russian crisis by mailing postcards to addresses. This is actually...
Look, if you look at business... no, if you look at SMB verification that happens, even Google does this. If you're registering your business on
Google...
Miguel, I have
a PO box in the US which forwards all my Amazon stuff to India. I mean, I'm getting mail there. In 3 days, it's here. I certainly think it is a responsibility of large-scale platforms now. I don't think I could have said this with any face maybe 4 to 5 years ago, but to start a process where they verify their users, whether it's a Twitter or a Facebook or a Google, they have in-country things as that. I know there's a lot of issues around authoritarian regimes, but at some point you have to start striking that balance in reasonable countries with reasonably free speech laws. I think they should take a call and saying that, look, if we can verify somebody in our algorithms or in whatever sense, they get a bigger voice, they get shown better. If we cannot verify somebody, we are not going to entertain them beyond the fact, even if they're going to pay to boost their...
One quick addition, that there is also strength in anonymity that a lot of vulnerable communities get. So that balance is tricky, right?
Very tricky.
And so therefore, I mean, there was a pushback against Facebook when they were doing the real names campaign as well from people who wanted these communities to be anonymous and allow themselves to be anonymous. Mm-hmm. You shouldn't...
My issue is that if you're paying to boost, if you're paying large amounts of money as an advertiser, as a booster to these platforms, if you are putting out that thing there, if you're paying Facebook to boost posts, if you're doing target audiences, at some point somebody should ask, hey, is there somebody backing this, not censoring their agenda? I actually object to a lot of the censorship that is happening on social media because of this, but at least find the person who's saying it, and if they're going to spend hundreds of thousands of dollars, as the Russians did in pushing certain posts to people, verify who these people are.
That doesn't solve the WhatsApp problem in India, right? The pace which, at which it happens.
My mother will still believe every WhatsApp.
I just would like to quickly respond to that. Although I know where you're coming from, none of that will help. And I'll tell you why it will not help. It will not help because I may be a verified user who will still produce a story saying that there are chips in the 2,000 rupee note, and then whole lot of, I mean, as an anonymous person, and then you will have a whole lot of legitimate people pushing this, and then you will not know, etc.
But I want consequences for that guy who put that story up in the first place.
So coming back to this...
Traceability and consequences.
So coming back to this, as I keep underscoring, bring journalists back into the conversation. Let journalists who have put in a lot of years working on this, using traditional skills, bring them back into positions where they'll be able to take decisions. And that's the first sort of... thin red line you will be able to create to push back on fake
Some
news.
Film star will tweet it, and then the journalism. I mean, it's so the same. I agree with you, it's the same problem.
I'm very divided. I actually agree that the problem here is that there are not enough consequences for people who put out stuff there, and I don't know what the solution to that is and how we can find a way to do that. I mean, often you do know that a particular post goes back to a certain ID or whatever, and it's just so complicated in this country in particular to hold people accountable for that. And I think we really actually need to. How you do that without trampling on free speech rights, I don't think free speech means the right to defame somebody or tell lies about them, or you know, just basic, some things are just lies. You can hate them, you can criticize them, but some things are just lies. But how to, you know, hold that, make that person accountable is very difficult. Like I said, I'm not joking, I swear to God, my mother gets like some 10 WhatsApp forwards every morning. I would say 9 out of 10 of those videos that she looks at she's, you know, convinced that that person has 3 heads. You know, I mean, that's the kind of stupidity that comes on WhatsApp, and a lot of people believe that it's true, and it'll be like some chain, you know, that you need to spread this information. Even about health issues, I found it very scary. Have so much turmeric, have this much mirchi, your cancer will go away, you know, and a lot of people I found believe all this crap. Yeah, but it can be, I mean, you know, among other things. So I don't know how you hold people accountable for that, and you can't blame the platforms, I think, completely.
So we've been having a long debate on what the media can do and can't do, about how it's difficult, we don't get enough time. I agree with all of that. But we are all missing simple tools. Google image search. It's such a simple tool. You can take a YouTube video, just take a screenshot, you use it on image search, it throws up the first time it appeared. We are not, we are simply not doing the basic amount of research that we should be doing. I know of credible news organizations which are focusing on web-first reporting. Web-first, you are sitting in a conference, you are tweeting, you are also writing your stories. How are you going to use all of this? How are we going to build it into it? I mean, I guess you guys are at the top of the ladder here. You should be able to probably
I can't tell you how many times Google image search has gone wrong.
Okay.
And I think it famously happened with a judge's photograph, was it, that Times Now had put out? Or I think time with the, that whole defamation suit and all that happened. Yeah, yeah. So it can be quite a heavy consequences to pay if you get that wrong. So it has to actually go beyond a Google search. Because Google and Wikipedia, please, my God, please don't believe Wikipedia either. It's such bullshit.
It's not a question so much as, you know, there's a lot of venting going on. And it's because it affects all of us. So I just thought maybe I could add one thing to sort of anchor what we've been talking about. I think fake news intersects with what I would call 5 P's. And so the first one would be policy. So we've been discussing policy. The second one would focus on platforms. So that's the second P. So we've spoken about how solutions need to emerge from a policy and a platform perspective. We also have a publisher. The publishers, that's the third P. The fourth P is people, because it doesn't matter if you put out fake news. If people have their own cognitive biases, they will believe what they want to believe. And the fifth P is very closely related to people, that's psychology. So if any solution to fake news will have to take into solutions from all 5 P's. So I just wanted to point that out, because you know I was feeling a bit like we're all over the place and we're discussing and we're seeing a lot of things.
I think one of the reasons why people tend to believe a lot of what is put out on social media, which may not be correct, is also because there's a lack of trust in a lot of mainstream institutions today, whether it is government and whether it is the mainstream media. And there's a good reason for that. I think often the mainstream media doesn't even realize it, but it has a certain inherent bias in how it reports things. And I think there are people who just feel that we're not hearing enough of the other point of view or other points of view. And I think it's our job to gain that trust back. And I think the way to do it is to present all points of view, to be fair and to give the facts. It's a very simple, I think, a traditional way to do it. But I think we all need to reflect in the media why that trust has gone. I mean, the US is facing the same problem. They were all convinced Hillary Clinton would win, even on the morning of the election result. We were in, Nikhil and I were in Boston last week for this Harvard India conference, and my cab driver in Boston, great guy, was telling me about how his kids, they live in a neighborhood where there are lots of Indians and Chinese, and because the Indian students are so bright, the school standards have shot up, and he was really happy that, you know, he lives in a predominantly Indian neighborhood. But then he said, oh, you went to Harvard to speak and all that, and he said, my problem with Harvard is that they like you if you articulate a point of view that they agree with. And he turned out to be a voter of Donald Trump. And I said, well, after everything that's happened and, all the, stuff he's been doing, you still support him? He said, yeah. He said, because I think people are just out to give him a bad name. They're not willing to listen to him. I think the economy is looking up. So I was just listening to this guy. And he was like, I don't believe what the New York Times writes. I don't believe, and so I think we need to sort of tap into that and try and understand why there are people like that who really inherently don't trust the mainstream media now. I think if you go into the US today, there'll still be, I think Trump's core support base is still intact, no matter how many polls you do otherwise.
So one last question before you go, Niti. How do you rebuild that trust now?
And that's I'm saying. I think it's just by doing our job, which we've forgotten how to do. I think we've really forgotten how to do our jobs.
Can I just change? So, yeah. Niti, one of the problems of fake news is because of the pressure to get out there quick. And there was some time back, some movement started saying there should be slow news. Do you see that newsrooms start to think about doing a little slow news, which is deep fact-checking, make sure that all the sources are credible, make sure that the research is okay. Do you see that anybody has started thinking about slow news as an alternative to, just quickly get out there and therefore make mistakes?
Look, honestly, nobody's doing that. I mean, we are doing that, and that is why, like I said, hum maar kha jate hain fir ratings mein, because we'll be the last to put something on because we have to verify it. But most people are not doing that. No? They're going, if one channel puts it on, you know immediately the other, you know, there's Tweedledum and Tweedledee, which ones are. So if Tweedledum puts it on, Tweedledee will put it on. And then Tweedledee's B plus will put it on. And then there's a C plus version also. So, you know, they will all just copy each other, and nobody will have actually made a phone call to find out if this is correct. And, you know, that is worrying. Again, I say that we just have to do, Nikhil, it's, to me, the solution just is do your damn job. And do it the way you were supposed to do it. Oh. And I think, honestly, most news organizations have forgotten how to do that. Today, television has huge problems, but there are people who are still doing a great job, even in these times, I think, who are standing out for doing just their job.
Particular news channel was asked to come up with an apology, and it denied that I will not come up with an apology. So in that scenario, how to make people accountable or news channels accountable?
You know, we have a body that is actually supposed to hold news channels accountable. And by and large, I think most of us follow what the NBSA tells us to do. And if you've made a mistake, you have to apologize. You have to follow the rules. There are some channels, however, who have... I mean, you know, what a shock, who have decided that they will brazen it out and they will not. So I believe that while this has been a good first step, and I don't believe that there should be any government interference or anything like that, you have to make a body strong enough to really, I think, monetarily really strongly penalize a news organization if it is if it has spread fake news or you know, put out misinformation. I think news organizations have to be accountable. We are not above the law. We are not we are not above any accountability. And you know, here apologies are printed on page 13. I'm sorry, it doesn't cut it. It should be on page 1 very boldly if you've made a mistake and if you've done something wrong. It doesn't happen like that on TV. Unfortunately, it will always be broadcast very prominently. And page 13 apology doesn't cut it, and I agree, there need to be stronger standards.
The question that you had about, you know, whether it's a speed thing, and journalists are in a newsrooms are at a tearing hurry to break the news, actually you will realize that the people who are spending time and taking it very slow is actually those who are creating fake news. There is a very systemic plan where they deliberately come up with these campaigns, and I think somebody like Prateek will speak more about it in the next panel. They are taking much more time and they are much more deliberate. So it's not a speed issue. The premise, according to you, might be wrong, but the fact of the matter is that there is a deliberate plan. There is a deliberate plan in which this information is being weaponized.
Sure.
So this weaponization...
I have taken a lot of trouble to create a fake story, but I need an outlet.
So let me just...
When the outlet gets my story, that's the responsibility of the media channel. See, your panel is about media channels, right? So what is the responsibility of the media to make sure that, you know, fake news doesn't go out?
So I'm coming to that.
So the slow news refers to that. I'll take my time to produce the fake news.
Can I answer that question? So the problem is not the speed, really. At speed, you might be able to address some of the... You might be able to make a mistake where you will have a genuine mistake and say that such and such event has taken place when it has not. But if you see where deliberately Twitter campaigns are created by some of these channels, where a deliberate amount of thinking is going to create a certain kind of perception, that's a very, very well thought out plan. And why is that happening? Why is that happening? The real answer is somebody like Mrityunjay and others will be able to tell you, because government today across many countries are deliberately working towards breaking down access to information. Your right to information is being killed systematically. Your open data is being killed systematically. They are ensuring that people have less and less access to authentic or real information because they know information is power. And unless and until we don't understand that where that power dynamics functions, we will never be able to address this. So it's not really, you know, it's not really a question about news sites, etc. Okay. It's also about denial of...
Lady has a question here also.
So my question's both to Nidhi and Prasad, since he's also here. The thing that you said in the beginning about, you know, just if you haven't covered something and that turns out to be fake, you shouldn't be debunking it. I think we need to start looking at debunking fake news as a business model, because I can say, I work for The Wire, and some of our top read stories are when we debunk fake news. And like 5 years ago, even a site like NDTV, who would have thought that you will have an offbeat section? Offbeat section is practically you putting up stories written in 15 minutes about something going viral. So if you make that sort of an investment, considering now the tone kind of seems to be like where we're saying bad media versus good media, let's okay not talk about the bad media. Let's focus on the good media. Let's focus on what we can do. Why not make a business, why not come up with a business model where you have a dedicated team just fact-checking? Why not learn from the mistakes from the American media?
I actually just want to say that in the course of this discussion over the last hour, I completely agree with you. This is something I'm going to go back and propose. Maybe it's time for us to have a show or something where it's just, the alt news of TV, you know, and I will propose that. And we will have to see if that's something that the bosses ultimately agree to. But I think it's a good idea. I think it's something that we should explore. I think we've been very, as a media organization, very traditional in our approach towards journalism by and large, but maybe now with times changing, it's something we should consider. So I think it's a good idea.
Look, here's the deal. Each time there is so-called fake news published on anywhere, there is somebody who's held responsible in most places. I have worked across 3 sites now, so I know that for a fact that holds held true in NDTV, that held true in Times of India. That holds true whether you like it or not in the Z group too. That said, in the last 6 months, maybe if I look at my organization, there's one piece of very embarrassing fake news that has gone out, which is identifying some sod in UAE as the crown prince. That was maybe one instance in 7 months, right? So when you're looking at it, it's not a problem that is programmatically done. It's not something that is agenda-driven in many cases. And each time, organizations do take steps internally to assess this problem and to solve it. In many cases, actually, we've slowed down. In many cases, we've actually stopped taking content from WhatsApp. Most of our stories are now not coming through on WhatsApp.
Why not invest in a desk? I'm sure Z has multiple websites, a desk who runs social media friendly stories. Why not invest in a desk? Considering how well these do, Prateek can vouch for that, how well these stories do.
You should check out Z News more often. You should check out Z News slightly more often. I think we are debunking fake news on znews.com as well. And that holds true for all the sites I run, which are about 14 of them.
So I'll rephrase that question in one line. Does it hurt you as an organization, and I'm not only talking about your organization, but other organizations, when guys like you, big organizations, put up a story and then somebody says, alt news, Prateek, can you verify this Z-wala story is correct or not? Does it hurt?
It does.
I would just like to add one quick thing on this. I think one of the things that you're assuming is that all viewers and readers are helpless, hapless, naive victims. I disagree with that view. I think if I see around the world, and you know, Nidhi is not here, but I'll give you a similar example. I was in a cab driver. I was talking to him in London. He saw I was Indian. He was from Pakistan. He'd been in London for 10 years, and he opened his phone and he started showing me his daily reel of atrocities committed by the Indian army in Kashmir. Now, those are photos which were actually from Syria. They were obviously from Syria, but it had been very beautifully packaged, this, that, in Urdu, Hindi, etc., and were floating across the entire thing. A 2-minute conversation explaining to him how to identify it, he could also understand, but 2 things which I discovered. 1, people want to hear what they want to hear. They want to believe in certain things. If they do not like a candidate, if you do not like a certain politician and you see a adverse fake news story about him, you want to believe in that and you will forward it across saying, yes, this is right or wrong, and you will want to believe in that. And the second issue that comes from that is as well, because you can't, one is you keep debunking it. But as far as the cognitive biases, as one of the gentlemen has put it, and we saw this throughout the US elections, no matter what you tell a person or a media outlet tells, at the end of the day, individuals have to be trained to decide how to figure out what is fake news or not, and to not weaponize it themselves.
I think the
the extremism in content generation is inevitable because internet allows you to target groups based on identity, ideology. Earlier, I think what used to happen is news organization had to address a mixed population, which had all sorts of political views, all sorts of ideological views. So they had to keep their output balanced. But now each ideological group or identity group actually has a news organization that it would go to get the news of the day. People don't go to multiple news sites to get a balanced view. So this confirmation bias is exactly this is so this I think this is going to increase because as internet allows news organization to target the generation even more specifically.
Prasad right now mentioned about the sword who was mistaken as the crown prince, but who is that sword? His name is from Sharjah. His name is Sultan Al Qasmi, and he is one of the most sought after commentators on the Middle East globally. That's the kind of fact checking we are missing today. Prince Qasmi is one of the most sought after Middle East intellectuals globally. He writes regularly, he writes on art, he writes on politics. Nobody understands the Arab world as much as he does, and we don't even as editors know who he is. And that's where we are failing in our journalism. And unless we fix that, we will not be able to address this.
One thing on the point of investing, and everybody's brought it up, where should we put the money? Yesterday I was talking to a VC, deep-rooted, and deep pockets, been in the business since 187 years in media. And he said, you know, what will go away in the next few years is if you look at P&L and the percentage of spends which is highest, which in media business would be salaries, that's going to be replaced by AI. And it's already been happening across the globe. AI being a distribution, they collect news, they will figure it out, make a short piece of it, send it out, and that's what's... So if that is going to be the next place, and I'm not talking about advertisers here, because advertisers, you can penalize and... But you know, funding, that is where Google succeeded, where Facebook succeeded, so much of deep pockets, and largely because they get clicks and they get the audience. So I don't know how businesses would face this reality, because investing and the more money is going to go into AI, go into machine learning, figuring out from news whether this news is fake or not, and how is that going to pan out for media businesses. News desk investing and on field investing is going to be reporting investing is going to be like so impacted.
Just in response to this, Tom Wheeler, the former FCC chair, a few months back he had come out with something called using public interest algorithm to tackle the problems created by social media algorithms, including fake news.
Hi, I'm sorry, I'm feeling a little hapless and helpless here. I've been hearing a lot of passionate talk here, but I have four suggestions very simply. Number one, I haven't heard anyone so far speak about the value of training. I think the only answer, and this is based on my 23 years with Reuters, is a constant cycle of training where we drill it into every single journalist repeatedly, and not just once when they enter the organization, but 5-6 times a year. You free up journalists to go through training courses so that they improve their specialization, they improve their ethics, and so on. And that is not happening in our organizations. Number two, the second suggestion I have is that editors need to be held accountable for mistakes and fake news, and this is not happening enough. When I was the editor at Reuters for quite a few years, we had my target was 0.5% errors, which means one mistake in 200 stories. And that mistake had to be corrected immediately because that could have market impact. So editors' bonuses and career progression was based entirely on whether they were accurate or not. Number three, quality control. I heard some talk about setting up units and so on, a business model. But more than a business model, each organization needs to have a quality control unit within itself. Because what will then happen is that you have a daily shaming and naming and shaming of mistakes made, and that increases the collective kind of responsibility for making things clear. And number four, you need a group of trained watchdogs who are able to catch fake news when it occurs. For example, more and more of the stuff that we see nowadays is visual. It's either video or pictures. Someone referred to photoshopping. But I mean, the number of shocking images that have been photoshopped over the years and that have been caught by sharp-eyed editors is just amazing. And I'm very proud that we have a few outfits in India like Boom and Alt News and so on that are doing a great job of this. But it's something that has to be a constant battle. And when you have a credible organization that is based on some of these pillars, that starts to become a go-to place for people who don't know where to look when they get flooded with the morning WhatsApps and so on. And I mean, there's no point in going on wringing our hands and saying, we're getting snowed under, we're getting swamped, we're getting swept away by the tsunami of bad and fake news. We have to build up credibility, and that word is now starting to become very, very rare in conversations.
So just a question for all the journalists in the room in terms of your newsrooms. Are there metrics that are tracked in terms of number of errors? Anyone?
There are metrics that are tracked in terms of the number of errors, and maybe I didn't get it right, but was it one error per 200 stories? Yeah. I think on... Right, but I'm saying on most digital platforms, by that standard, I think we are doing brilliantly because it would be one error per 5,000 pieces of content published.
I'm talking about a high-speed wire agency situation where speed is of the essence, and you've got to put out 80-character news flashes that move markets and so on. So we're talking of situations where you're beating everybody else with market-moving news. I mean, obviously, things must be better score-wise, but I'm talking about the kind of tolerance for error, which needs to be extremely low. I mean, you hold editors responsible and penalize them for getting things wrong.
Okay, I think first thing that we need to talk about here is, especially because, again, we're calling this fake news and online content regulation. I think we need to get rid of the word fake news because that puts a focus exclusively on the news industry. We're talking about disinformation and misinformation of different kinds. And the reason for that is primarily that the platforms, Google, Facebook, Twitter, Amazon, all of these guys put all kinds of speech, whether it is me putting up a status, me putting up a picture, someone putting out misinformation, an advertiser trying to put out an ad, everything is put on the same level. And therefore, everyone can claim the defense of free speech. So this is where we need to talk about disinformation and not fake news. Because when we come to content regulation, we will start regulating news. News is being censored globally. If you look at the solutions that China has adopted, where you try and send certain keywords across messaging platforms, those keywords don't travel. So this is what is going to happen if we don't get this straight. Second thing is, this is very similar to what happened immediately after the printing press was invented. There was chaos globally. But 100 years later, you had Reformation, you had Enlightenment. And if we try and regulate things at this stage, where we are still figuring things out, the speed at which fake information is being generated is happening exponentially. We have deep fakes now. Today, Baidu published a paper saying that if you have 1 minute of audio, you can generate audio, any kind of audio. You can mask any kind of voice. You can put on any kind of modulation with a single minute of video, which otherwise would have taken hours of video and audio and whatever. So we are moving at an exponential pace. We try and regulate things right now, we're going to fuck it up for everyone.
Yeah, I do want to echo what the lady was saying about the AI-generated fake news. I think so far we've only seen text stories. I heard the audio word come in, but I also know that the AI engines now can do very interesting video morphs that you can't distinguish between the original and the fake. And that opens up, you know, all kinds of very spicy possibilities that, you know, obviously will start happening right now. And this will be used by the political class. So if your capital comes out of defaming or shaming your opponent, then one of the best even the Crown Prince story, sure. It's not the Crown Prince versus the, you know, Sultan, which is the issue. The issue is that that had a really high potential payload. And that payload of the message is what prompted somebody to say, let's put this out without doing the check. The media room people have to be more responsible to the payload that they are carrying. It's not the content that's so important. It's the messaging that they are going to. Individuals will do a different thing, but media has to be more responsible. I believe they are right now not being that.
So three quick points. One is, of course, what Chaitanya said about training. And this is something that me and Nikhil were discussing before we started. In every major large corporation, as a part of their corporate culture, they have L&D teams, dedicated learning and development teams. And in most great institutions, you have L&D. The one institution which actually doesn't have a dedicated L&D team is actually the news industry. And that's where I think there is a huge, huge gap. And for the survival of the industry, this should be something that you should constantly look at. Like, you look at the army today, the army at various levels, as a young officer, as a mid-career officer, etc., is constantly training its people. And this just doesn't happen in the news industry at any structured level. That's the first thing. Second is, I would again caution people, do not, in any information warfare, the terms that you use are very, very important. So if you do away with the term fake news, you will actually end up playing to the into the hands of the people who don't want you to use it. It's very important to call fake news, because to a lot of people who are believing that crap, to them this is news. So therefore, we have to constantly use this term to distinguish between what is fake news and what is not. Because when a news is sent to you, it will not come to you using the word disinformation. It will still come to you as news. So the only way you can counter it is by constantly harping that there is news and there is fake news, so that there is a recall value and people are able to understand that. Thank you.
In fact, just to add to that, Cyril, if you've seen in case of privacy, right? The privacy issue has been divided into three separate parts. One is privacy as a concept and a right. Second is data protection. And third is data security. So they've taken one issue, split into multiple, and if you point out some issue that is interconnected to everything, they'll say, oh no, that's a different issue here, right? The problem that we're facing is that disinformation is, whether you call it fake news or disinformation, it is the same thing. It's not necessarily coming from news organizations. I would go back and say, what is a news organization and who's a journalist today? Because everyone's creating. We've seen this disaggregation taking place. The only place where there is consolidation of credibility today that exists is in the media. And therefore, we have to find ways of getting and retaining that trust back. Because effectively, the media is the only thing you have going against this kind of disinformation and this weaponization of information. Krishan had a point.
Just a small point to add, actually, talking about responsible media. So I think one reason why the media is in the shape today that it is in the country is because mainstream media does not report on other media groups properly in this country. You will find journalists and editors tweet like whenever somebody's got something wrong. There's no critical reporting of media as a beat properly. And if there are no self-regulatory bodies, like, you know, there are toothless bodies like NBSA or some other bodies, then media can put pressure on media to correct its course.
Well, in fact, we've done this in the past a couple of times where we've actually been really happy when someone's reported something wrong, because then we go out and say that, hey, listen, this is false. Come to us to trust us in that sense, right? We've got it right. And I think that competitive streak also needs to be there. Aditya? Final comments and we move in.
Sure. I think, you know, for more and more, and I just want to touch upon three simple things and then give a quick plug for some of the stuff that we are doing. The first thing, look, for me, at the end of the day, it comes back to accountability, right? And whether it is as an individual, as an organization, and who you're accountable to, whether it's your society, governments, organization, advertisers, but at some point, we have to put in the line in the sand and say, people are accountable for their actions, and we need systems and processes to ensure that accountability, especially as more and more we are seeing that people are feeling that they can get away with saying things with no consequences.
Okay, hold on a second there. Where do you define accountability? Is it going to be with the generation of fake news? Is it going to be with the distribution of fake news? Is it going to be somewhere where the consumption is taking place?
So I put as it in, what is the duty of care? If you are generating few fake news, for sure, that accountability lies with you. If you are somebody who's casually forwarding it, I don't know if you are forwarding it rises to the duty of care that you have to look. If you're claiming to be a journalist or a media organization, then you have a duty of care to be held accountable. At what level, how, and what should the consequences be? That's for a complete day session on debate. But I think everybody has to be kept accountable. But I do agree there has to be a framework of where that accountability lies. And, you know, punishment fits the crime.
Because accountability translates into liability, right? If you go back to the 66A,
absolutely.
If you go back into the 66A case, in that case, it was one person who'd put up the information, another person who had liked it, and they were both put in jail at that point.
No, I agree. So for me, again, it's the duty of care aspect. One is the generation, and second, intent matters, malice matters. We have very good old laws which cover libel and all. We don't need new ones. We need to go back and see the spirit. I highly recommend you see the last 300, 400 years of British libel laws, the Commonwealth, how they came up with it. There's a lot of amazing debates that have happened on really trying to understand that one is an accident, one is malice, one is someone has done it with an intent, and these laws have existed, perhaps not been updated towards this. But I do say that I don't have the answers on this, but I do say we do need an accountability framework, and we do need one fast. And we need it from both sides. Somebody sent me, and I don't know if this is fake news, I have not verified it, but the UK police, I think 3,000 home visits they have done last year alone, because of something somebody posted on social media. The last two things quickly in the interest of time. One is, I'm more worried about the siloization. You can have media outlets who'll get it right, but if nobody's coming, if nobody's tuning in, that's a problem. And the last plug, our foundation is doing two things. This is the Sarani Epa Journal Foundation. We are giving grants to journalists, 3 lakh rupees, string-free, without quitting your jobs, to pursue something that you really want to pursue for 6 months on anything in India, as long as it's enlightening and as long as you've taken the time to do it well. And we are also offering to any news organizations which want free training sessions to any journalists, whether it is to deal with fake news or just learning how to use a video camera properly.